Chapter 8 of the HYLDR Chronicles. This chapter is called Milk Well. Not Milk Well, but the Milk Well. A faint mist lingered over the snowy fields opposite Elivagar River. King Ögni stood patiently on the other shore, hoping to spot a deer or a flash of golden hair between the silver birches or dead ferns. Further down the river, a series of statues could be seen, sculpted by no other than the king himself in his younger days. He had carved these massive slabs out of Nibelungen slate into watchful ravens, guarding the natural border between the lands of Vanaheim and Helheim. For how long the realms had been at each other's throats, he could not say. The old ravens were witness to the never-ending feud, and Ögni felt himself turning to stone, waiting for a neglected loved one to appear from the past. He knew that Skald had been there all these years, watching over him while he lost his battles, his wife, and the will to fight. Every time he set out for the woods to hunt, or pretend to, he knew she would be there, somewhere, respectfully out of sight, unwilling to undermine him. When did I lose my mind? Since when do we thrive on respectability and appearances? Wage war on the wood folk? To hell with you, Gunnar! We don't deserve to live here. The Huldra certainly don't deserve us. I should have married you years ago, although you haven't aged a bit since we first met. How could you ever still love me? Ögni thrust his sword into the thawing snow on the riverbank and lowered his head in despair. That's when he thought he saw a firebird floating down the river. When his eyes focused on the curious sight, Ögni felt the island crack in two. A trail of blood poured from a mane of gold. Skald's golden hair. He dived into the freezing water and dragged Skald onto the same inlet where he had found his daughter playing with a snake. Her skin was light blue, and her face was a picture of sorrow. The king held her against him, as if to warm her dead body. He opened his jaws and screamed, a deafening silent scream, leaving permanent wrinkled grief all over his face. When he closed his bloodshot eyes, he felt a shudder of hope when Skald's skin shriveled to soft velvet brown. But there would never be any hope left in the king's heart. The doe was dead too. Ögni carried Skald to the raven statues. He wouldn't burn her and send her body to well. She didn't belong. She belonged with him. And here is where he would bury her. And he would join her soon. Two oversized swans glided on the surface of an egg-white underground pond. they exchanged a subtle look and shed a tear, almost in perfect synchrony. A drop of white liquid fell from a white stalactite and sent rings of ripples towards their slender, feathered bodies. The heavy-hearted moment passed as discreetly as a calm breeze through weeping willow branches, and the swans lowered their necks to watch the now immaculate plate of milk they were bathing in gently deform. The tip of a nose of china rose out of the water, and a shiny face emerged, trailed by the body of a young woman. Sune was lost in anxious daydreams. He couldn't begin to fathom why Voluspa would abandon him. Not a word from his mother, not a single message. Had she been snatched by villagers? Or had she fallen down a well again? Or simply died of old age? He snapped out of his desperation when the swans suddenly trumpeted in unison. Soon he lifted the bedraggled body of HYLDR out of the white waters and lay her down on the white clay floor. He used a blue cloth to delicately wipe the milky moisture from her skin, slowly rubbing her limbs with mortuary dedication. He cradled HYLDR for a while, humming an odd tune from long ago. The swans fluttered their wings, and HYLDR began to shiver, choke and violently shake in spasms. She spurted out a river of warm milk from her mouth that the splattered floor immediately absorbed. Now you are reborn again. Sune, said the two swans in thought, where is the monarch of the howling cauldron? Verdandi, Irpa, I don't know. I've told you 1,000 times already. And this human has suffered 1,000 deaths or more. Is she the Milkwell Monarch now? Is that possible? Soon he helped HYLDR to her feet and rubbed his tired eyes. I don't know. You should know more than I. Although you don't get out much, do you? Why would we need to do that? We are guardians of Milkwell. The well needs us, and we need to swim the white waters. When she fully wakes, you'll know if she is what we suspect. Do you think she crossed to the other side? Asked Sune, placing his arm inside a hole in the white wall where a round door was situated. When she wakes, you will know. If she growls or she squeaks, you'll know the answer to your next question. If you say so, replied Sune, feeling his skin being prickled by the door's lock mechanism. The exit slid downwards, along with a corridor of metal feather blades that sank into slits in the ground. HYLDR gazed at him with dopey eyes, then pushed him away. She staggered forwards and felt her way along the dark tunnel, slanting uphill. The swans circled away over the milk pond and trumpeted their goodbyes. Eleonora was in the kitchens giving the new cooks the grand tour. She showed them where the pails and brushes were to mop up the blood and was about to explain what her culinary preferences were when she saw her highly esteemed guard, Gunnar, sneak out of the pantry. He hadn't expected the queen to return so soon without Toki or the king, and knew he would have to drop his plans for the day to suit the queen's mood. Now I know you don't need to be reminded what happens to traitors, said Eleonora, nodding to the bloodstains. But I would like you to meet the man who saved me last night from a distasteful death. Whatever could we do to repay you for your swift bravery? Gunnar observed the two young women and huffed. Nothing, I'm afraid. I was only doing what is expected of me. Please, let us treat you to your favorite dish. What would please you the most? If I told you, you wouldn't have a head to see what I'd be doing to you. Gunnar closed his eyes and inhaled deeply. Well, if I must, Arctic fox on a stick would have been perfect, but I will go for mushrooms and roasted donestead, rare, if you have any chops at your disposal. Anything you wish, said Eleonora. Rest by the fire and put your feet up. You haven't seen Toki, have you, by the way? Gunnar felt a tingle of electricity run down his spine. He shrugged in denial and quickly left the cooks to their affairs. On his way to the Grand Hall, one of his spies brought him an intercepted falcon message. It was addressed to Asmund. Apparently, the witch was somehow in Helheim's custody, or a guest, they claimed, within the White Walls. Prince Hedil himself requested a parley amongst heirs to the throne, alone, at the tip of Dragon's Tail, which meant the place where Elivagar River splits in two around a small islet of protruding rocks called Odinn's Eye. Gunnar wasn't convinced that the prince would make the necessary choices. He was infatuated and weak, a recipe for disaster. This was most possibly another trap, and if not, a rare opportunity to capture Helheim's heir to the throne and force the enemy's hand. Lunch was not yet served. Gunnar sat at the dining table with Asmund and Eleonora, waiting for the king to return from his hunt. Order for anyone? Asked Eleonora, passing some marinated dough entrails around the table. The kitchen really needed some new blood, no pun intended, and the chefs know what they're doing. A bird in the hand is worth two in a bush, if you get my meaning. Not quite, my dear. Care to elaborate? Said Asmund dispiritedly. This one's a keeper, said Eleonora, plopping a morsel of meat into Gunnar's mouth. Saved me from poisoning, killed the perpetrators, and now they've been replaced by better chefs.
If you don't mind me saying, replied Gunnar, I think I've proved the opposite to that saying. We've always despised the cooks around here, and we found a better replacement since their demise. I always thought that it meant that if you take a bird away from its habitat, like a hedge sparrow from its nest in a bush, then you are depriving nature of two possible eggs. Said Sten, the royal head groom, seated further down the table. We never see the beauty that's right before our eyes, said King Ögni wearily, covered in mud and blood.
Don't get up. Let us eat.
The king sat at the head of the table. He looked as though he had a foot in the grave, eyes distant and lost. What happened? Are you all right? Asked the queen, genuinely concerned.
Not now.
Gunnar flicked two fingers, commanding the cooks to hastily bring the meal. Asmund had too much on his mind to be burdened by another one of his father's hunting accidents.
Gunnar,
a falcon arrived. What was the message? Perhaps not the right timing, Prince Asmund, he replied.
Go ahead, Gunnar,
said the king under his breath.
Very well.
Your son has been summoned to Odin's Eye this evening for a parley exclusively between heirs to the throne. The message comes from Helheim.
And?
Said Asmund impatiently. And Prince Hedil himself specifies that our enemies have captured the woman from the sea, Kyoko, our former prisoner. Asmund rushed to his feet, slamming a chair backwards to the floor. But the king bellowed at him to sit, which he did. My son, you lack patience and foresight. Who knows what their real intentions are? They have her, Fadir. You don't expect me to sit here and do nothing, do you? They trespassed into our lands and kidnapped her. Technically, Nebelwood belongs to all realms, said Sten. Or no one, replied Gunnar. All things being equal, we must act cautiously and plan this parley with great care. We could have Prince Hedil fall into our plate willingly. And risk having Kyoko murdered, said Asmund, gripping the table knife. Eleanor gestured him to put his antics on pause as the cooks hurried in from the kitchens with an enormous plate of roasted dough. Ögni recognized the smell without looking at the dough's sagging head, still attached to the cooked meat, and felt his bowels twist. His throat burned as bile filled his mouth and dribbled over his cracked lips. He gaped approaching dough, in terror, falling backwards off his chair. He shuffled his feet and hands on the floorboards, trying to get away, and moaned. Everyone was baffled, wondering what had really happened to the king on his outing. Without warning, he got up and staggered to the table. He grabbed the plate and sent it crashing to the floor. The dough's head cracked on a wooden pillar, and after the cooks had run off in tears, the hall fell silent. Nobody dared interrupt the awful still. In a low, faint voice, the king murmured,
"Tonight, we will not go to the Eye of the Plains. We will summon every last fighting spirit we have left in this realm and deliver a final blow to Pass Castle. Prepare the the cavalry. Gather the troops. It ends tonight.
King Ögni left the table and walked past the doe carcass, staring up at him. He placed a stool in front of the roaring fireplace and used it to reach the iron gripper gloves hanging from the wall. Still warm from the flames below, he put them on and punched his metal fists together. In his mind, the din of thunder shook the eardrums of everyone around, summoning his people to the final battle. In retrospect, the iron gloves made a tinny tap sound when they crumpled together, but no one was foolish enough to speak their minds. The king then turned to those seated and drew his sword, the deadly Dine slave. No one sheathed, only death may follow.
May your victims howl in agony, my king, cried Sten, standing to raise his own sword.
Oh, they will, that I can assure you, replied Ögni, tears pouring down his cheeks.
To war.
Asmund looked at what his father had become. An empty shell. A frail memory of the feared demon he used to be. Whimpering for no good reason.
Oh, what a fool.
Asmund slipped away discreetly to the stables and left at once, hoping to reach Odin's eye in time. He wouldn't let anything happen to Kyoko ever again, whatever the price to pay. Gunnar read him like the stars and informed the king of Asmund's betrayal. Ögni didn't react as planned and slumped into his chair by the fire.
They should never have returned, mumbled the king.
My lord, I fear your son has turned against us, that he will join the enemy to save the woman he loves, whispered Gunnar to his ear.
He'll do what he has to do, said Ögni. At least he has the balls to run into the jaws of hell and fight.
I don't follow, sire.
I don't blame my son. He's braver than his father in many ways. But he will be used as a smokescreen while we crush Helheim. Now leave me and prepare for war.
Gunnar raised his eyebrows and left the Dour King to mope alone. Queen Eleonora had been busy that afternoon. She was probably doing all she could to take the dinner incident off her mind and forget about the upcoming battle, the possible end of this debilitating war. Her husband wasn't himself, and she was dead certain the blonde woman in the woods was to blame. They would pay too one day.
Gunnar, you can take a break from annoying the berserkers and upsetting the horses. I have something to show you.
Not now, your highness. We have urgent matters to attend, if you haven't noticed. Eleonora gave him a smile with stern slit eyes. You will do as I command. Gunnar found himself surprisingly out of ideas and was forced to follow her to the stables and ride east towards the shore. The final battle was upon them. What was she up to? The sun bathed the shore in unusual heat.
snow was thawing quickly, and the sea was no longer a prison wall of ice. Three guards were standing on massive eggshell rocks, gazing out to the distant low tide, surreptitiously creeping closer over the dull brown sand. The beach was covered in dried out seaweed that crackled under the boot. Crabs scuttled from one dark green cluster to another, keeping out of the angry sun. Eleonora called out to the guards. They looked down to the beach, then walked away, nodding as they passed the odd couple strolling over to where they had been standing. When Gunnar peered over the barnacle rocks to see what was below, he felt a prick in his neck. It wasn't the shock of seeing the traitor Toki chained to a rock that caused a similar painful sensation of alarm, but Eleonora's deft fingers digging a poisoned needle into his spine. Yes, he did mention you knew of his cowardice and dishonesty, said Eleonora, holding Gunnar as he fell to his knees like a doll. Gunnar tried to mutter a bundle of excuses, but only bubbles of saliva exited his lips. You two rascals, always eager to be elsewhere when I didn't have sufficient information to divulge. You must have thought so highly of me, and who could blame you? I didn't see you two worms coming, did I? Worms indeed, pathetic maggots! She exclaimed, clawing his face with sharp nails. Take this back to your masters, she added, kicking the sack of flesh and bones over the edge. Gunnar grazed his head and torso, and broke a wrist when he hit the hard sand. I could wait here to watch the ravens peck at your flesh and crabs nibble your eyeballs. Or if I cared a little, I might stay until high tide and enjoy your last bubbles of breath pop out of the sea. But you know what? I don't want to see you two insipid limpets one moment longer. Enjoy Yvonne's nightcap. She made it especially for you. Good riddance. Gunnar's body was almost entirely paralyzed. His right ear was stuck in the sand, and he groaned as he failed to move his body round towards the horizon. Was it worse to not see the water rising, or an ironic last strike of luck? Regardless, something else was rising. An acute wave of pain spreading from his toes to his shins. Bones felt like they were being splintered. A spiraling terror awakened as a sound of metallic pebbles being brushed by the tide grew louder and louder, distorting and spinning out of control. He screamed inside his skull and the pain continued to rise, burning his pulverized nerves. Gunnar couldn't control a thing for a rare moment in time, and he felt water splashing against his spine, although the sea was still far out. Toki whimpered with fluctuating tones that had a windy cavern-type quality. His wailing turned to snickering as he admired his companion's plight. When he gazed back at his sliced-off genitals being devoured by oyster catchers, the sniveling resumed. Blood dripped onto their beaks as they swallowed the shriveled flesh. Hilda could hear muffled lamenting in the distance, someone calling her name. She watched her family having lunch without her. Not one person mentioned her absence. They waited for the king, but did they bother to care about what had perhaps happened to the princess of Vanheim? Not in the slightest. When her father fell to the floor like a terrified kitten, skeleton hands tugged at Hilda's shoulders, trying to pull her away. She fought them off erratically, as if brushing sticky cobwebs away, but her hands passed through the bony fingers. The vision of her father burying the dead doe waxed and waned as fast as a curtain being drawn, and the skeleton hands went dark grey. Powerful drog arms pulled her willowy body out of the howling cauldron and threw her onto the floor. Long blue tongues retracted and sank into the fiery well. Hilda tittered as if she had gone mad.
I told you to stay away from the well,
growled Sunni, shifting back to his normal form. He hadn't quite mastered the restraint, as Valuspa called it, and still felt the urge to lick her thumping heart. Hilda looked straight through him, still drowning in the magnetic flames. Apart from her childhood friend, she was certain that nobody else would bat an eyelid if she listened to the calling voices and jumped down the well. The doors behind them slid open, and three drogs entered the chamber with blood all over their faces. They said nothing to Sunni and ignored Hilda sitting at his feet. All three were calm and had a graceful step. They opened a stained sack and tossed hearts, livers and eyes into the well. When they had emptied their bags, they slit their wrists and shed a few drops of their own blood into the simmering blue. The well seemed to exhale in delight, and the drog solemnly walked away. Hilda gave Sunni an inquisitive look, and he said, "Wait and see." Shortly after, the howling cauldron puffed out a series of small violet objects, no larger than rhino beetles or deer droppings. They released diaphanous blue smoke, then faded to various colors, very similar to Hellsots, gasped Hilda.
That's right. This well produces very special ones you've never tasted before. Come with me and I'll show you how to wrap them correctly.
Could you show me the other wells first? Said Hilda softly. How many are there? Sunni hesitated, waiting for Voluspa's wiser judgment, then replied,
There are three in total. At the tips of the three main routes.
So there's only one left for me to visit.
True. Perhaps neither Karl nor Vor will mind if we pay them a visit. Although I doubt Kara will be present.
Out of the blue, Hilda asked, What is a Norn monarch? And why did the Swans say I had suffered 1,000 deaths? Sunni was caught off guard. How could she have heard the Norn Guardian's conversation? Unless When she fully wakes, you'll know if she is what we suspect. Follow me, Hilda. I'll tell you all you need to know, he said in thought. Hilda frowned as Sune quietly left the chamber. She followed him along the tunnels, and Sune couldn't conceal his mixed excitement and perplexity. So much was changing too fast. The warm sun was low in the sky, almost ready to kiss the crest of the Nibelungen Mountains. Elivagar River was alive with a silvery glint of smolt racing towards the sea. Herons and cranes filled their bellies with wriggling young salmon, while opportunistic gerfalcons filched the occasional fish that slid out of their beaks onto the frosty banks. There were rope bridges on either side of Odin's eye, and as one crossed one on foot, he was tense and ready for anything. His side of the islet was bathed in shadows, and the backlighting from the setting sun made it hard to detect the enemy. An owl flew off, and a man stepped out of a miry grove from the center of Odin's eye. It has been a while, son of Ögni, said Hedil, placing his sheathed sword on a rock. We used to play here so long ago, remember? We drifted apart, thanks to our father's war, and yet I feel I know more about you than I should. I thought you'd be taller by now, son of Njal, replied Asmund, following Hedil's lead and unarming himself to a certain extent. And what is it you know about me that my sister has told? I thought we'd carry that secret to the grave. How long have you known? Let's call it a wild hunch, said Asmund, crushing a sleepy snake's head with his boot. Hedil tried not to be intimidated by Asmund's daunting size and stepped closer, ignoring the headless snake wriggling on a warm rock. Is she all right? How did she react? React to your kidnapping my Kyoko after crossing our lands? I would say her mortification was nothing compared to my opinion on the matter. I'm guessing it was my sister who gave you the missing key. Hedil felt his chest pocket and took out the key. Your Kyoko was locked up in a cell to rot. She was dying to get away, and it only took one innocent invitation of mine to get her to leave, said Hedil, throwing the key to Asmund's feet. What have you done with her? He replied, picking up the key to acknowledge the gesture of goodwill. We haven't done anything to harm her. We didn't toss her into a freezing prison in the middle of the woods. She's warm, better dressed, well fed, and grateful. My cousin has taken her under her wing, and I have not witnessed any deadly curse that has poisoned our people. Well, not from her. Asmund clenched his fists, exposing lead-white knuckles. What do you want in exchange? I didn't have trading cattle in mind, Prince Asmund. I was going to suggest a truce. A long-term truce. Haven't you had enough of this futile war? Seriously. Asmund looked his enemy in the eye and tried to decipher how serious he was. He rubbed the rusty key between his fingers and placed it inside his coat. To tell you the truth, that wouldn't be so bad. If Musblein doesn't stab us both in the back while our guard is down, that is. A truce would be acceptable. If you give her back. Asmund, she isn't mine to give. If she wants to leave Helheim, she's free to do so. I would even go so far as to offer you free passage if you wish to check on her well-being. Far from the dungeon of Neverwood. Wouldn't that be convenient? You'd have nothing to gain from having me stroll inside the white walls, would you? Bring her to me, and then we'll see how glad she is to be the White Dragon's guest. I don't see why not. After the Green Elk's hospitality, who wouldn't want to run back to your loving arms? Said Hedil, I will tell her exactly what you told me. I'm sure you will, said Asmund, stepping back to where he had put his sword. Hedil, son of Njal, I will be expecting a falcon with promising news. Make a wish. Did you bring any black teeth with you to drop into the wishing well? Said Hedil, referring to the old well in the middle of the islet. It was said that one could make a request to the gods by throwing into this specific well a ripped out tooth after chewing charcoal or having dyed black teeth. Perhaps I could borrow a few, added Asmund with a grim smile. A truce, Asmund. I came here to propose a truce. Try to keep that in mind. You can always make good. Flocks of birds filled the skies as an army of Helheim warriors on horseback stormed eastwards. They crossed the shallow part of Elivagar River with blasting horns and clashing shields and took off for Vanaheim, leaving a muddy trail behind them. You treacherous adder, cried Asmund, running for his weapon. I didn't know, Asmund, I swear. On my beloved's head, I bet. Fetch your sword and face me, you coward. Was it not you who abandoned your family to go fishing for a few years to make sure it didn't have to do any fighting? I see no other way to shut your mouth than to lob your head off, said Asmund, swinging his red sword, reflecting the bloody sky. Hedil dodged the deadly blade and rolled backwards to his own iron sword. It was far more dented and scratched than Asmund's, and he feared it wouldn't last one more battle. He was also furious that his father would use him like this without sharing his intentions. He didn't want anything to happen to Hilda. If ever they succeeded in crushing Vanaheim this time, and this duel under the eye of Odinn was of no importance to him. Nevertheless, there was no escaping Asmund's jealous rage. Asmund dashed forwards and lashed out, aiming for the chest. Hedil deflected the heavy blow, digging his sword diagonally into the boggy ground and kicking Asmund's knee. The kneecap didn't shatter, but Asmund lost his footing, which gave Hedil time to get onto his feet. Momentarily, the red sun splashed Asmund's face. Hedil used whatever he could to his advantage against this wall of muscle and swung his blade horizontally to slice Asmund's neck. A lock of chestnut hair flew over the blur of iron. Asmund ducked in time and thumped his assailant's wrists, hoping to disarm him. Hedil winced but held on tight to his grandfather's cleft blade. Dragon's tongue would not let him down. He quickly stepped to one side and struck Asmund with frightening speed, causing him to stumble backwards. Edil felt a warm flow of energy flood his veins, and he reiterated his attacks, pounding Asmund's thick blade. The stronger man withstood the impressive surge, but understood his sister's secret lover was not to be taken at face value. His eyes were ablaze, and Asmund's instinct warned him to tread carefully. With a roar, Asmund jammed his sword between the two points of Hedil's cleft sword. Using his superior build, Asmund pushed Hedil back, forcing him to bend his knees. But the Prince of Helheim was no novice with such a weapon, and twisted his hilt. Asmund groaned as his wrist suffered the agonizing contortion. With another scary acceleration, Edil moved to his right and slid Dragon's tongue down Asmund's blade. Vanaheim's heir could see what was about to happen, but was too slow to react as Edil swiped the back of his gloved left hand. Blood gushed out, and Asmund was left with one useful arm to fight with. That wouldn't stop him. Asmund visualized the Jormungandr before him, an obstacle keeping him away from Kyoko. The worm had to be slain. With a deafening battle cry, he hoisted the heavy sword up with his right hand, spun around and thrashed his enemy with shattering strength. Edil defended himself, but the clash of the iron caused his bones to shudder. His ears rang as Asmund delivered an even heavier blow. Edil knew his battered blade would not resist another beating and dodged by rolling in Asmund's direction, drawing a concealed dagger, his mother's deadly scoffnung. Edil maimed the man's calf, and Asmund tumbled onto his back. When Asmund lifted his head to face his opponent, the last needles of sun twinkling through the grove dazzled him. "Enough, Asmund! I have to find your sister. She's not safe," said Hedil, retreating towards the trees. Asmund snarled.
"You stay away from her. You're the one who isn't safe."
The wounded leg didn't hinder Asmund's determination, and he hobbled forwards, dragging his sword with one hand through the sodden grass. Edil retreated through the grove, bumping into branches and scraping his skin. When he turned to see where the well was, Asmund charged forwards. They both fell, caught up in brambles, and dropped their weapons. Asmund grabbed Hedil's belt and received a boot to the jaw. Hedil scrambled through the lacerating brambles over to the old well and used the circular stone walls to help himself up. Asmund was already onto him with both hands around his throat. Years at sea had strengthened his grip, and Asmund squeezed Hedil's neck like a mooring rope tightening around a bollard. As life was fading from his eyes, Hedil whispered a sorrowful "Hildr," which made Asmund loosen his grip. From out of nowhere, Hedil drew multiple knives and slashed Asmund's arms. With great speed, Edil dashed out of sight, around the well, through the dark trees, and over the rope bridge to his horse. Concerns of pride and bravery mattered little to Edil in comparison to Hilda's safety. His claws retracted, and he galloped across the river, shouting to Asmund still on the island, "Save yourself! I'll save your sister!" "Run while you can," bellowed Asmund, unable to sprint to his own horse.
"Kyoko, worry not. I will free you myself."
Vigrid's snowy plains were pale blue in the waning gibbous moonlight. Patches of green grass were beginning to sprout, revealing remains of many old battles. Horns and drums cracked the silence. All of Vanaheim's warriors found the energy to plow through the snow towards the purple dusk. Helheim would not survive this unexpected onslaught. King Jarl and his brother-in-law led their troops to victory and were convinced of the same outcome. They forgot their dreariness and despair and built up a frenzy to smash down Vanaheim's gates and burn the lot to death. Only Hilda and Eleonora's mounts were left in the royal stables. Loyal to the very end, even Sten had joined the delirious king. Eleonora drank manna wine from an aurochs horn with a dagger close by, just in case. Her husband's schemes hadn't worked out so far, and that was when he had his wits about him. "Where's Hildr when you need her?" said the queen to the dainty flames. "For Odin's sake, where is the girl? I haven't seen her since." Eleonora felt a rush of guilt, knowing she had forgotten about her stepdaughter. She picked up her dagger, dressed into her warm, long wolfskin coat, and hurried to the stables, where her horse was all alone. "So tell me, Sunne, what did Voluspa mean about the hidden powers of Bloody Hoof's sap and the cauldron being a gateway?" asked Hilda, walking up sticky steps to the second well. "Your memory is as sharp as your tongue," Sunne replied, walking behind her. "My mother told me that one day you would be ready to take the test. That would be when one of the wells may have let you live. It certainly did, didn't it? Not my choosing." "We don't all get to choose," said Sunne, touching a trapdoor in the floor with two fingers and swiping it with three others. The door scraped sideways, displaying a pit of darkness. "Is this the test? I'm not sure I want to go down there," said Hilda, holding Sune's arm. Sune's blood began to boil, and he inhaled deeply, emptying his mind. "I'll go first if you wish. This isn't one of the rituals, it's just an entrance." "More than one, eh? Tell me about the rituals beforehand, please." "Not now, Hilda," he said, removing Hilda's hand. "A little hint as to why I should be doing this?" Sunne could hear the rush of hemoglobins in her veins. He could smell the scent of her sweaty flesh. A torment with nobody to help him restrain himself. He blocked out the sound of her oily voice and recited the Nornish litany a few times. "When the blood from Eikthirnir's antlers floweth, indigo worms on fire, whisper the calm of rising red moons, whisper the calm of rising red moons, whisper the calm of rising red moons." "Susu, tell me." Kitsune did not open his eyes, and the color of his skin wavered.
Hilda, enough! I'll tell you this, and then you will descend. The wells require guardians. The swans and I are some of them. The wells need monarchs to ensure their safety and to guide us. Without a monarch, the balanced harmony of the great ash tree's roots is put under stress. Without all three Norn monarchs, I fear. Nothing good, I'm guessing. To put it lightly, you didn't notice how warm the howling cauldron was, did you? The snow is thawing rapidly, too. We need someone to take the reins, temporarily rule over the three wells. Mother said it could work. The Hyldr haven't had a supreme Norn since Urdr was killed. Our son was meant to lead us. Skuld and Kara say Refer was reborn, but I've yet to meet this so-called Woodland King. Hilda saw Skuld bleeding to death in the woodland stream. Hedil's mother. She shook her head to empty her mind. But why me? Sune wanted to tell her, but fought an inner battle to hold back his hunger, and grabbed Hilda's hand to jump down the hole. He turned round at the last moment to see who was running up the sticky staircase. A colossus of a man ripped Hilda from his grasp and kicked him down into the pit of darkness. The stranger picked Hilda up under his arm and ran back down the stairs as if each step were melting into thin air. As many bizarre smells and sights flashed by, Hilda was surprised to not be afraid. She was somewhat relieved to be whisked away from a terrible, unknown task, and relaxed by a familiar feeling of freedom and comfort. Her ear pressed against the man's hairy torso. Hilda thought she recognized the rapid beating, the rhythm, the acrid scent. Freya? She caught herself thinking. They flew past the cave entrance and didn't stop until her kidnapper was out of Neverwood. He gently put her down on flattened grass where snow had melted and turned to leave. Don't go. It's you, isn't it, Freya? Out of habit, the man didn't reply. You know, I was pretty certain you were a mare and not a stallion. How can that be? Freya took some time to break the silence. Years of servitude, of pretending to be a domesticated animal, had almost wiped out his identity. Why, he was really living in the realm of men, spying on them for the Hyldr. The routines and weight of time had crushed his reason to hate humans. He would have given his life to serve the king's daughter. He would have galloped into battle for her, had she not been manipulated by the same person who had forced him to live with the folk of Vanaheim.
Hilda.
He managed to utter.
Yes, I am a mare, but deep down, I am also a man, as you can see.
So it is you, Freya, said Hilda, bitterly weeping at the thought of her most loyal friend, the only friend that came to save her. Another Hyldr.
I came to take you home.
Your father is sick. Battle has begun. The order of the mist is broken. You must do something to stop him, said Freya, dropping his hands to the floor and cracking his bones back into shape to become Hilda's mighty fjord. Take me to him, Hilda whispered, holding the horse's head in her arms. In the woods, where the snow had once hidden the woodland shrine, water now trickled down a muddy slope to the iron gate, wide open. Eleonora held a torch over her head, stepping carefully into the dark to avoid slipping. What are you doing, El? This girl has despised your existence from the very first day you set eyes on her. Poor thing. Nobody really gets her. Nobody sees her true value. Eleonora peeked into the prison and called out Hilda's name. She took a deep breath and went inside to make sure Hilda wasn't really there. At the back of the ivy grotto, fireflies were performing a mesmerizing aerial choreography. Eleonora slowly approached the bioluminescent ballet so she didn't scare them off. A few fireflies flashed their sallow lights on and off, and floated over to land on her head. The main troupe was dancing around the statue covered in ivy. Bending her knees to take a closer look, Eleonora tripped on a thick ivy branch and toppled over, crashing into the firefly totem. Her torch, she had dropped, scorched a few leaves and twigs and unveiled a skull staring right back at her with shiny yellow eyes. The queen couldn't breathe and got up so quickly she forgot the torch. It was so dark outside that Eleonora knew she had to go back. The fireflies had gone or switched their lights off, but her torch was still on the floor, highlighting the skeleton bound in ivy. What a horrible sight. Of course, seeing people get their skulls emptied or chests cracked open wasn't uncommon. But the visual effect was lugubrious enough to scare a black cat. Eleonora bit her lip and hurried over to her torch and picked it up. See, nothing to it. Without warning, she felt something electrocute her neck. A smooth grey hand slid under her chin and lifted her head to meet the fiery gaze of an angry drogue. She saw the dying flame of her torch reflect in the shadow's eyes, and a drop of her own blood spattered on her trembling lips. Who are you? She whispered, unable to move under the drogue's charm. The drog drew closer and licked the blood off her wet lips. He sniffed her forehead and replied, "You smell of mud here," which made Eleonora smile inside for a fraction of a second. Refer held Eleonora's head with both strong hands and paused for a few heartbeats to practice Kara's lessons of self-restraint. He didn't see the point and ate through her lips, cheeks, and jaw muscles. The queen didn't make a sound as the rumored woodland king bit through her tongue and sucked out as much warm blood as he could in one go.
But you aren't my Modir, are you?
Eleonora's head fell to the floor, and her skull cracked next to Ordul's, the Norn monarch of Blackwater. Another well, commonly known by the HYLDR as Orphan Webs. See you next time for chapter 9. Of the HYLDR Chronicles.